Let me just start off by asking you a question. I'm asking for a response. What do you think is going to, what do you expect to happen in the Steelers game today? How many expect a win? How many expect a loss? How many of you expect to see crybaby Tom Brady on the ground with James Harrison standing over him? Yes. How many of you expect the Steelers to score at least 35 points? Ooh. How many of you expect the Patriots to at least score 35 points? Okay. But in case you don't know, there is a game. I'm wearing my blocky Jack Lambert AFC Championship jersey. Every time I've worn it, they've won the AFC Championship. So, Okay. So, but in the end, it is just a game, isn't it?
No.
It is just a game. It's an important game, but it is a game that we develop this list of things that we expect to happen and things that we expect to see and things that we want to see and things that we absolutely think are going to be a part of it. But let me ask you a question, and I truly want you to think about it this morning. What did you expect to get out of church this morning? Did you have as many expectations about what was going to happen and what was going to take place in our midst today? I know it's not an AFC Championship game, but it is a soup cook-off day, so we've at least got that going for us. But what did you expect to get out of church today? And it's a dangerous question to ask on soup cook-off day because some of you expected to just come and get your belly full. Anybody want to mess up with that? That's one of the expectations I had of coming to church today. Or how many of you come to church regularly because that's part of your routine and that's part of your weekly schedule and it fits in, and so you don't want to throw off the whole weekly schedule. You know, you want to start it off in the right way. How many of you are like that? Can I have a few of you? Some of you are here because you either have a rough week in front of you or a rough week behind you, and you come expecting to kind of get your batteries recharged and want to go away from here feeling better than when you came. How many of you had that kind of expectation? Okay. Some of you are here because you were forced to come. Your expectation is that I will be done preaching by a certain time and that you'll get to go down and eat soup or get to go home. But no matter what your reason for coming, I think that honestly very few of us came here with honestly thinking about what our expectations were going to be of what we were going to receive when we came to church today. Sometimes we come to church because we really need church. We really need God to move in our lives, and so we come expecting great things, and a lot of times when we come expecting great things, you know what? We receive great things. You know, Paul would have never settled for the level of expectation that's in God's church. In fact, it always seemed like Paul was trying to raise the bar of what people expected when they came together. Because after all, Paul was an expert in lifeless religion. He knew all about that. Paul was a Jew of all Jews, he liked to brag about. He grew up worshiping in the Jewish synagogues. He knew all about lifeless religion. And after coming to Christ and after having his world turned upside down, he wanted nothing to do with that anymore. And so he was going around trying to raise the expectations of believers all over the world. That's why we have the majority of our New Testament. It's Paul writing letters to churches trying to get them to raise their expectations about what they should be and what should take part in their churches. But you know what? Paul didn't just want to transfer the fire inside of him to those churches in that day. Paul had a desire to put his fire into every believer. And that's a big reason why we have the book of Ephesians. As Paul writes the letter to Ephesus, he includes in the very first chapter a prayer for the church. Now normally, when you finish up a letter, you would have a prayer at the end of the letter. But here we have a prayer right smack dab in the middle of a letter. And so what Paul is doing is he's given an introduction. He's trying to tell them the blessings that they receive and all the good things that God's going to do through them. And now he's kind of giving a prayer to set up the rest of the book of Ephesians. But Paul wants the words of this prayer to raise the expectations of those in this church. So let's take a look at Paul's prayer. We're going to be reading in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 23. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 23. And it says this: "For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the Lord God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope of what to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way." You see, Paul wants these believers, these Christians, to grasp what is theirs, to take hold of their inheritance, and to raise their expectations about what God is capable of when they meet together and expect great things. Before we take a look at the specific thing Paul prayed, let's ask the Lord to bless our time. Faith, would you pray for us this morning?
Lord, it is so good to be in your house, Lord God. Father, we expect, Lord God, to just be filled with your Holy Spirit today, Lord God. We expect, Lord God, that you, Lord God, will just speak to our hearts, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, that, Father, you just want to just elevate who you are, Lord God, in our lives. And Father, I just thank you, Lord, that Father, you're pouring out your spirit upon Pastor Doug as he brings forth your word with boldness and truth and with understanding, Lord God, of your word. And I just thank you, Lord, that Father, you are filling our hearts with your love. In Jesus' name.
Amen. So the first thing that Paul prays for the church is that Paul prays for the church to have a spirit of wisdom and revelation. Paul prays for the church to have a spirit of wisdom and revelation. Hopefully, many of you come to church expecting to learn something. How many of you come to church expecting to learn something? That's a good expectation to have. It's a common, reasonable expectation to have. And after all, if I'm going to ramble on for a half an hour, at least you should get, you know, a few nuggets here or there or to learn something. But the gaining of knowledge, while it's a good thing, is not expecting near enough from your time in church. Because you can gain knowledge at other places. And knowledge is the basis thing that you could do in church or in any situation. Because to gain knowledge, all I have to do is state a fact that you didn't know before. You receive that fact and you receive that fact. That's what gaining of knowledge is. But Paul wants us to raise our expectation from just gaining knowledge and memorizing a few facts and acquiring some new tidbits of knowledge to something else. Here's our scripture this morning. It says, "For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better." You see, knowledge is just the start. But we have access to things that are greater than knowledge when we become Christians. And the first of that is wisdom. How do you attain wisdom? You ask. Remember, we said it from James that if you ask for wisdom, you will receive it. And it's a blessing that he gives. But wisdom is not a mindset. Wisdom is not attainable by just listening to me. Wisdom is a spirit. It is the Holy Spirit in presence, giving you the ability to take that knowledge and turn it into wise action and wise words, and knowing how to use the knowledge that you've gained. You know, the Greek word for wisdom is sophias. Sophias. It's the word that the same Greek word that we use for the word sophisticated. So what we're asking for is for God to give us a spirit that helps us to understand sophisticated knowledge, or higher knowledge, or higher learning. Our time together shouldn't just be about gaining more information. It should be about gaining more wisdom and knowing how to use that information in our lives. But Paul doesn't even stop at just wisdom. He says there is a spirit that brings wisdom, and the same spirit brings with it revelation. So what is revelation? Does anyone know? It's the ability to have a special understanding that can't be seen on the surface. It's as if God is reaching in and he's... The older I get, the more my mind goes away. Okay? It goes away. It doesn't have the things that... But it's taking off the fog. It's taking off all of your limitation. And it gives you the ability to see under the surface and understand what is going on. This gives you the knowledge to know what to turn to when the situation is difficult. Revelation is being able to read those words in the scripture that were so confusing at one point and now it just jumps off the page. Why didn't I see this before? That's revelation. But wisdom and revelation only come through the Holy Spirit. So what we need to do is we need to have the expectation, and we say that we do, but do we really? That the Holy Spirit is going to be here, the Holy Spirit is going to show up, and the Holy Spirit is going to take the knowledge that is given and turn it into wisdom and turn it into special revelation. You see, God does these things for a specific purpose, and it's mentioned in our scripture. He gives us wisdom and he gives us revelation so that we can know him better. That's why. So we accept the Spirit. The Spirit brings wisdom. The Spirit brings revelation. And we become more intimately in tune with our God. That's why this is so important. The goal of this is so that we receive wisdom, we receive revelation, our relationship with the Lord is strengthened. You see, knowledge is all about what we attain in our head. Wisdom and revelation are about what we attain in our head and in our hearts and in our bodies and in our spirits. It's like a full body learning experience. The Holy Spirit comes in, He makes room and allows us to get wise and for the Creator of the universe to be revealed to us. Because as sinners, if the Creator of the universe were revealed to us, we would reject it. But now, we become bodies who are capable of the Holy Spirit coming in, and He starts to make room and say, okay, now this part of you is ready to understand. Now this part is ready to understand. And then it makes us into vessels who carry out God's purpose in wisdom. So Paul prays for the church to have the spirit of wisdom and revelation. Second thing that Paul prays for. Paul prays for the church to have the eyes of their heart enlightened. To have the eyes of their heart enlightened. You know, another good expectation that people have when they come to church is that they want to leave with a good feeling in their heart. How many of you? Scott was talking this morning about not starting your sermon off with, you brood of vipers, you know, as your first words in your sermon. But you like leaving knowing that you've met with the Lord and He leaves your hearts feeling joy and love and peace. And you leave here experiencing something that you would not have experienced if you would have stayed home. How do we want that expectation? Now, that's something that we desire to have. But what if I were to tell you a secret that would help you to unlock that expectations every time you walked in the doors so that you could make sure that you were going to leave with your hearts being touched by the Lord? Let's look at what Paul prayed. He said this in verse 18. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which He has called you, the riches of His glorious inheritance in His holy people. Paul, first of all, tells the people here, the key to having your heart touched by the Lord, the key to all of this is to make sure your heart is enlightened first. What does that mean? It means that we need to shine a light on our hearts and see what is in there before we come together. Because I don't know about you, how many of you had a sin problem this week? Anybody else? Three of us. Amen. But we go through the week and sometimes we fall and sometimes we fail and sometimes we make mistakes and all of these things come and it causes our hearts to be darkened. We need to take a look at our hearts, to check our hearts, and to shine a light on them before we come together, to make sure that before we even meet, our heart is in the right place. And if we will enlighten and light up our hearts before we come, and all it does is to say a prayer. Take a look at your heart before you come and say, God, I'm sorry for these things that I've done. A simple prayer over a minute. I'm sorry for these things that I've done that are not in your will. Please forgive me. And that will open us up to a new world when we come together. When our hearts are ready and we meet together, God will touch it every time. And then, once we've opened up our hearts, once we've enlightened them, then they will be able to see things that were not there before that we could see. Once you have lightened up your heart, it says that the eyes of your heart will be opened or enlightened. This is something I've struggled with for a while. When you view a couple of eyeballs on your heart, it's not a pretty picture. So what's he talking about there? We have to add it back to the revelation part that we just talked about, that you'll be able to see things as God sees them and not as man sees them. You'll be able to look at a situation and see it unfold in the spiritual realm and not just in the physical realm. It means that you're allowing God to reach into your inner man to touch your thoughts, your emotion, your intellect and will, and to change you into someone who can see the things of God. Enlightening your heart is setting your heart on fire. Enlightening your heart is setting your heart on fire. We used to talk about that. But when you bring the light of Christ into your heart, you cast out the darkness, you become a fire, then there's one that's burning within you for the things of God. Now, how many of you would love to come expecting that every week? But it starts with you. I can't do that for you. There's nothing I can say. It's you have to come prepared saying, God, cleanse my heart. Set it on fire. And then you'll be ready to receive the things of God. I think of the two salesmen. They sold shoes for two different companies. And the company sent them over to Africa. And the first salesperson, when he got over there, he said, he called back and he said, well, he said, there's not much of a market here. No one wears shoes. And the second salesman called back and he says, we need to get over here right away. No one has shoes on. This is an open market. Both of them saw the same thing. But one of them saw the possibilities, the things that could be. That's having the eyes of your heart enlightened. To seeing how God can work and will work and can move. It allows you to grasp every opportunity. And also, as it says in our scripture, the result of having your heart enlightened for every service is that you are guaranteed to have hope when you leave. It says, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you. And we know that hope is one of the three greatest things. The greatest things are faith, hope, and love. So you are guaranteed when you come with your hearts enlightened that you will receive when you leave one of the three greatest things on earth. That means you'll keep coming back with more and more expectations, and more excitement, and more people with you. Because it will spread. Hope does not disappoint. We are promised. Paul prays for the church to have the eyes of their hearts enlightened. Also, lastly, Paul prays for the church to have the incomparable power of God. You know, every once in a while we do come to church with great expectations. You know, maybe you're facing a health crisis, or you have a family member or friend who has an upcoming surgery and you're unsettled, or maybe you have a friend that's battling a serious disease, or maybe you're just at the end of your rope. And you're in a situation where you've tried everything and you don't know what to do. And so you come to church and you ask God to come and to touch you, and he does. But according to Paul, we shouldn't just come to church expecting God's power when we're sick or when we hear about a disease. Because this power is far more than just a healing touch. We think that God's greatest work is when he reaches down and cures us of a disease. That's just the start of what he has to offer. Listen to this. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. So, we have nothing to compare it to. We can't even come up with the words in our own mind to understand what we can compare God's power to. But Paul begins to explain it to us. He said, that power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead. Okay, taking a dead person, making him live again. That's what he's comparing this to. And, not or, and the same power that raised Christ from the dead and took a person, a human, and put him and seated him in the right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all other rule and power and authority and dominion and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, not only the names that we can come up with now, but also in the ones to come, the ones that will rise in the future, and God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. If we could grasp like 150 of this, if we could just hang on to the power that is available to the Christian. As a church, we need to be under the headship of Jesus Christ. That means he's in charge of all things that happen. And it also means that we have the access to the same power that was displayed when Jesus beat death, and the same power that has been given rule and authority over every power on earth, and that we have at our disposal an incomparable great power that's the envy of the whole world. Do we come expecting to find that? You know, a lot of people talk about how do we fix the problems in this world? How do we make everyone come together in this time? You know, God already provided a solution to the problem. It's the church. The church is God's plan to save the planet. And so it needs to be the power supply to the world. And it needs to be the example to the world. And in order to do that, we have to place ourselves under the headship of Jesus Christ. It needs to be filled with Christians who are filled with the Holy Spirit, who don't just talk about the Holy Spirit, but are filled with the Holy Spirit and are in the will of God. We can no longer just allow ourselves to have enough of God that we can understand. We need to take the limits off, and we have to come expecting. Fern asked us a question on Wednesday night. She said, have you ever been praying in a room and the foundations have been shaken and the whole room started to shake? And everyone looked at each other and said, no. Well, maybe we need to start expecting that. Because it did happen, and God is not a respecter of persons, and it can happen again. But we let our mind get in the way. We have to come with the Holy Spirit inside of us, charged up and ready to go. We need to be on the edge of our seats just waiting for the Holy Spirit to move and to work. And we need to give God the credit for what he is already doing. Doris Marks got discharged today. Ezra, who every other time that he has chemo has been hospitalized, but this time something is different. God is working in a new way. He does not have to be hospitalized, and new words are coming to his mouth. That's a miracle. This Lucy, who a couple weeks ago was diagnosed with cancer, now they're saying, oh, let's lessen the chemo treatments. This transplant person, what did you say their name was that got the transplant?
Oh, I don't know his name, Jason's friend.
Okay, Jason's friend got another body part from someone else put into his body and now can live out the rest of his days. Yeah. We don't oftentimes realize how much God does for us. But when we start to give him the credit he deserves for the things he's already doing, we can expect to see his power on display more and more each week. So what do you expect from our time together? I hope this message has encouraged you to come expecting more and more. And I pray that beginning next week that you come and you expect not to just gain knowledge, but to be able to take that knowledge and through the Holy Spirit of God, turn it into wisdom and revelation. And I pray that you would prepare for your time here to have the light shone on your own heart and to remove all darkness so that your heart's ready to be touched by God. And I pray that you would come expecting to see God move in power. As we close this morning, I just have a song on a little video for you. And I want you to focus on the words of the song. If you would like to come up and pray up front while it plays, if you'd like to just sit in your seat, it's up to you. I want you to spend some time asking God to raise your expectations and to unleash his power in the church.
I can see the waters raging at my feet. I can feel the breath of those surrounding me. I can hear the sound of nations rising up. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. I can walk down this dark and painful road. I can face every fear of the unknown. The same power that commanded death to wait lives in
This past summer, we took the youth to Creation Festival, and after watching concerts all day, we got to the next to the last concert that evening, and it was Jeremy Camp. And I'm getting older. Some of the were not my style, right, Heather? Yeah, oh my, she said. But right before this concert started, Doug Gunlock looked at me and he goes, "I think we should go up front for this concert." I said, "Okay." So we tried to convince some of the kids to go up front. "Oh no, that's an old guy up there rocking. What do we want to go up front for him for?" And walking ahead 200 yards, we fell into the presence of the Holy Spirit. And we saw a lot of concerts. We saw probably 20 or 30 concerts, but that one was the only one where the Holy Spirit was there and moved in power. And we were hugging people we didn't know, and we were holding hands, and we were just worshiping because the Holy Spirit moved in power. And I walked back to the blanket. Do you remember what I said? I said, "You guys back here didn't get the same concert we got up there, because the Holy Spirit was moving among the people in the front." That same power isn't just limited to the people up front, but the people who were up front were ready to worship. They were ready to meet the Lord. They were ready for the Holy Spirit to come in and to move. Can we make that our expectation? You come ready and you come expecting the Holy Spirit to move. And we'll see more power. We'll see more wisdom. We'll see more revelation. We will see more of God. And that's my prayer. Lord, raise our expectations. Lord, let us realize and know who we have living inside of us and the power that we have at our disposal. Lord, help us to come expecting your move. Help us to come anticipating how you're going to work in our midst. Lord, prepare us. We thank you, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Eileen, do you have any instructions for us for soup?
Well, I'm coming to get a trophy because someone in this room is going home with the dust catcher.
Yeah.
That's what y'all say.
We're going to try a little different because I'm the curse of never wanting to do it the same old way. So what we've decided is everyone who's staying, whether you brought a soup or not, come. There's plenty to eat. Never mind, it's a hot day. It's a soup day. So come down and settle yourselves. When we get everybody down there and at the table, we'll do our blessing, and then we're going to scatter who goes to what soups first. We've observed over the years, the first one, two, or three soups have always won. Not going to let that happen this year. So bear with us. When you're ready, come on down. When everybody's kind of in the room, we'll draw the soups out so they stay hot. And this, too, will be yours. See you downstairs.
All right. If you have to go home, do that. But you can get out and have a seat, and then they'll get everything.